This is episode 93 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about the group. For August 2018, we're discussing Mrs. Saint and the Defectives by Julie Lawson Timmer. So hi, I'm Millenia in Vietnam.
And I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And Roberta and I are two members of the Reading Cove Book Club. And today we are here to discuss our August 2018 Cove pick, which is Mrs. Saint and the Defectives by Julie Lawson Timmer. And it was chosen by our very own Roberta in Georgia.
Yes.
And what does everyone think about Mrs. Saint and the Defectives?
It's not going well for poor Mrs. Saint. It's not one of the better picks, unfortunately, even though it was mine. And you can be fooled by the synopsis and the reviews and all, and things get to be disappointing, unfortunately.
Yeah, so I haven't seen a post in the group from the rest of our members so far of anyone enjoying it.
Nope.
Everyone that's posted has pretty much said they were bored or they got sick of Marky. So we have to talk about Marky.
Yes.
Because, well, the book is entirely from her point of view. It's her book, her story, until the end where it kind of switches into Mrs. Saint and Simone's stories. And what's the man's name? Frederick.
Oh, no, Frederick, yes. Mm-hmm. Frederick/Edward.
Edward. So at the end, it kind of turns into their story, which I thought was jarring.
It was.
But to begin with, we have Marky, who I will just say I thought was very dumb in her marriage, but many women are. So I felt like she represented many women in that her husband wasn't treating her very well, and she was very interested in keeping up appearances because her parents, they raised her, you know, they were very shallow, especially her mother, I should say, her mother.
Yes.
And they raised her to really be appearance conscious. So at first she seemed like, yeah, she had been really shallow and she wanted to make everyone think everything was fine. So she looked the other way, even though her husband was had spent all of their son's money. The money he had inherited from his grandfather. He was cheating with all her friends, you know. Well, I don't know if it was all her friends.
But a good many.
Yeah, of her, you know, socialite, high society friends that she was, you know, keeping company with. Letting all the bills pile up. Got behind on the mortgage. And I think she didn't know that. She didn't know about that until the very end. You
right,
didn't find out about
late,
the mortgage.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All these outrageous things. And then when they're splitting up, when she makes a decision to leave him, she decides not to tell her son the truth. And I thought that was really dumb to just allow him to blame her for the breakup and not tell him anything. He should continue to have this saint image of his father. And he wasn't like 5 years old. You know what I mean? I felt like that was not age appropriate. He was a teenager. Don't treat him like an idiot.
Right. Right. I mean, she didn't have to go into all the lurid details, but
right.
She's still given him an overview of why this happened. I mean, I can see people don't want to bad mouth their ex, you know, completely, so it ruins the relationship with the child. But at the same time, to me, honesty is always important. You don't have to, like I said, give everything bit by bit, but just be honest and saying, well, you know, this is what happened and this is why we had to split up. So
yeah, and I mean, there's a
I think he would have understood. You know, he wouldn't have felt any worse than he did later.
It was just a boneheaded move on her part. And then, to boot, the whole repetitive nature of why he's upset with her, that she's not telling him the truth. It just kept repeating that over and over and over at every turn. And it's like, okay, yes, the reader gets that point. Move on. You know, it's like, yes, you're having trouble controlling him because he blames you and you've decided to let him blame you. And she just keeps repeating that in her internal dialogue.
Right.
Chapter after chapter.
Yeah. Well, and unfortunately we've seen that in some of our other picks that we care for. Is that was probably the biggest complaint is, you know, too much repetition of details that it really, really detracts from the story. And
yeah, just like, okay, it's not his fault. So she's letting him vent and be and giving him space for the way he's feeling, because none of this is his fault. Yes, we've heard that 10,000 times now.
We're bored.
Yes. And it's just letting him have his way with the friends and just being stupid, because she knew those guys were bad news.
Right.
And then it was just like the dots were put so close together. That was the other thing about the way the story was written. It's like mapping out exactly where it's going. Okay, he's in with this bad crowd and they're going to do something crazy. Right. It was like, okay, we see exactly where this is going. And then she's working from home, and there was a part where she went into her office, and then we get this blow by blow of what the business does. And I felt like it lived in that space way too long.
I agree.
I was like, really? Do we really need to know all this? It has no bearing on the story whatsoever. The corporate machinations and the operations of the business.
Right.
And then, of course, there's Mrs. Saint.
Well, you know, first, just like the cover picture with her looking over the fence, and there was a fence between them, but you could still see things over the fence. It just seemed like at first she was a real busybody and wanted to interfere in Marky's life and didn't understand, you know, what Marky was going through. And even though Marky was sort of like antisocial with all this, she didn't give up. You know, she just kept at her and get at her. And, you know, I think Marky eventually appreciated some of the things she did. But at first, she just thought she was annoying, but she couldn't really get away from her because she was right next door, and she just came, you know, traipsing over without any invitation and you know, did these things that Marky really didn't want, you know, or need, like the dog. Like, okay, here, your boy needs the dog. Here's the dog. Okay.
Yeah, she was extremely overbearing.
Yes, she was.
Did you not suspect that she owned that bungalow?
Well, yeah, I figured that out. You
from
know,
the beginning.
It was pretty obvious.
I thought so. And I thought it was painfully obvious. When it was revealed later, when she dies in the will, and then Marky's like, oh, Mrs. Saint owns the bungalow. Like,
so, yeah, you feel like, and you didn't figure this out.
I know. After,
you know, they saying like, oh, well, yeah, we can make a deal for the, with the
cable. Yeah.
Okay, you know, said, so, but you just don't think, for once you think, well, I'm pretty smart and she's clueless, you know, poor Marky.
Absolutely, yeah, clueless.
The only thing you could think is, well, she was clueless and she's so wrapped up in what we said in the Cove, like in this pity party, she didn't see the obvious sometimes. She just, you know, was off in her own little world about her son and work. And then after she got hurt, that was a hot mess too. So
yeah.
She's wrapped up in herself, and perhaps she really didn't see the obvious.
I guess not, but the author should know the reader would have. If the reader has any level of intelligence at all,
they'd say, oh,
that
okay.
Was so obvious that she was the owner.
Right.
And then her husband and all the staff that work there, her defectives.
Right.
The title of the book and why she calls them defective. And Marky was like, that's not a nice word. How dare you call people defective?
I know.
But I kind of liked Mrs. Saint's reasoning.
Yeah.
Then we find out she is a con artist, basically.
Yes.
Pretending to be French Canadian.
Well, I mean, and I could see sometimes trying to hide your past, but she just went to great lengths. And I think the reader would see it wasn't quite as obvious, you know, that was a little bit of a surprise at the end, exactly what happened. Mm-hmm. But you had to know that she wasn't, you know, representing who she really was, because she was so secretive. She didn't want to talk about her past at all. She just kind of cut that off. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the people that lived and worked for her, they didn't worry about it. They just accepted this. They just thought, well, here's this, you know, a lady who's given us a job and is looking out for us, so we're not going to worry about what else is going on with her.
Right.
You know, we're not going to talk about personal stuff. We just talk about day-to-day stuff and, you know, just everyday things. So they didn't worry about it, but I think it really bothered Marky because Mrs. Saint wants Marky to share all these things and ask her all these sort of almost rude personal questions. But then the minute she even asks anything of Mrs. Saint, she just kind of closes up, shuts down, like, we're not going to talk about that.
Yeah, and, you know, her being more of a mother figure to her, that wasn't that odd to me, right? Because she wasn't like a companion for Marky. They weren't the same age. She was much older than her. So I could understand that dynamic in the relationship where she'd be like all in her business, but, you know, don't touch my business. You know, I'm your elder.
Right. She was. And then it turns out at the end, you find out she's even older than what she said.
Yeah, she's a whole decade older.
Right. You know,
she completely rewrote her history.
Right. Right. And you can see part of it because if you didn't do something, you know, horrible like that, you'd want to get away from it. But still, it was sort of an unusual way of dealing with your past.
Exactly.
To totally invent yourself like that.
Yes. And then when we find out all of this at the end, the very end, like the final third. Not third, but like in the final quarter of the book, it's all about this reveal when she dies. And I wondered if she didn't intentionally kill herself.
I don't know.
I kind of got that feeling. I was listening to this, listening/reading some of it, but mostly I was listening on audio. And I just kind of thought maybe I missed something. But I wonder if she killed herself, like, intentionally with that cigarette. Because she didn't seem to be the type who would fall asleep smoking.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, just, you know. And her sister's there. And I don't know. I just kind of wondered, did she do that on purpose? And then her will was all in order. She had put Marky in the will. And
yeah, well, I mean, you know, if you're older, you pretty much need to keep your will up to date because you just never know.
That's true.
Could be any day. So I don't know. I thought maybe it was a accident or something, because back in the old days when more people smoked, you heard more stories of people, you know, drifting off with their lit cigarettes and things happening. But yeah, it's hard to say. Plus, you think, I wouldn't want to die that way. That would be horrible.
I know. That's true.
Off myself, I think I'd, you know, take a bunch of pills and just fall asleep. And she must have been on some sort of medication since she was older. And
yeah, you're right.
It's debatable.
I agree, though. She probably would have found a different way to do it.
that would have been awful way to go.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, and then we hear this very convoluted story about how he cheated on Mrs. Saint, and she dumped him, kicked him to the curb, and then, you know, felt sorry for him and took him back and made him relegated him to the basement.
Yeah, so he sort of became, instead of the husband, more like one of the help.
Like a tenant, yeah. Exactly.
You're a roommate and a helper, but, you know, you're not my husband anymore, so. But, you know, that kind of, when you look back, that sort of made sense that he was so devoted to her and went to great lengths to take care of things and do stuff for her.
Yeah, and then, you know, the reason why she cut Simone out was because their brother and sister had died or been killed in the concentration camp. And she wanted to, what was the reasoning again for why she and Simone?
I don't know the whole author's thing, but it seemed to me she just, as we said, she just wanted to get rid of her whole past. She didn't want to have any connection to it, and it was a lot better if she could just live this fake life. And I don't think Simone really wanted her to do that. I don't think Simone was living necessarily a fake life that, like, Mrs. Saint was. Like,
no, Simone wasn't willing to pretend they didn't exist,
right,
that their siblings didn't exist and hadn't existed. So she, Mrs. Saint, but I thought there was something else that made them fall out. I can't remember specifically now because I've read another book since this one, but
they still had a falling out more about handling, you know,
the past.
The past.
Yeah.
I think that's the biggest reason.
Yeah, and then Simone was living in New York, I think, and she was so hurt that Mrs. Satan and her sister didn't come to her son's bar mitzvah and, yeah, you know, different things. But Mrs. Saint had moved on. She wasn't Jewish anymore. She,
right.
Yeah, she had completely disowned that heritage.
Right.
Yes, and then we get whiplash when we go back to Marky for a happily ever after. Kyle even does a 180. And I was like, oh, really? So now he's back in the fold, all rehabilitated, and almost as if there's a door open for reconciliation between he and Marky.
Well, I wouldn't trust him.
I know. That's what I was thinking, like, no way.
I would be happy that he was trying to be more a part of his
Jesse's
son's life.
Yeah.
After he'd kind of, you know, been really almost cruel to him by always putting everything else before his son.
Yeah, and having him wait for him, you know, and then cancel at the last minute. Ridiculous.
Yeah, so it was just really mean. You know, if he expected to have a good relationship, that wasn't it. And I think good old Frederick, that I don't know part of it was just him or Miss Saint's nudging, but when Frederick was teaching Jesse how to do the different things with tools and everything else, mm-hmm. and then then Jesse could do this with Kyle, so I think that kind of helped form a bond. So
yeah.
Indirectly, the all the, quote, defectives help Jesse kind of reestablish with his dad. But his dad still, no matter what, his dad should have been there at the times he said he was going to be there.
Yeah. And then at the end, he suddenly changes. So I thought, okay, I guess that happens.
Okay. But I said, I still would trust him. I'd think, well, it's good that they can have, the father and son could have a better relationship, but I wouldn't necessarily take him back because
no, what? And I just, it didn't feel very well written. I guess that's how I feel about it. It just felt like, okay, it's the end of the book and I want a happy ending. I want to end it happy. And so I'm going to say, you know, Kyle's now being a good dad. And it's like he completely changes his whole personality for that.
Yeah, well, like I said, I would hope that, yeah, maybe he's come around to be a better father, but Leopard doesn't change his spots usually, so.
Or if it does, it takes more time, or, you know, there right. needed to be some more development of that turnaround.
Right.
But like I said, it felt like whiplash. Whoop! I know, like, oh, okay. This lousy deadbeat suddenly now has seen the light.
Yes.
So, yeah, I was really, really bored from much of this, and I thought it wasn't very well told. I mean, it wasn't a bad story, and the idea of Mrs. Saint and her past and Marky and her trying to deal with her son, there's nothing new there, but it could have been a better told story, I think.
It could have been a better story. It's another one of these where it had a nice premise and mm-hmm. Nice issues or important issues addressed, but it just wasn't told in a very good manner at all.
Yeah, and the title, this, I guess Marky is supposed to be, that's also a weird name, Marky, I thought, but for a woman. But yeah, she's supposed to be one of the defectives, but the story wasn't really about Mrs. Saint until the very end.
Right.
So even the title doesn't even fit the story, I don't think.
Well, I mean, maybe the author was thinking with the Mrs. Saint that she sort of, even though she wasn't each thing, she sort of overshadowed a lot of the stuff that went on mm-hmm. with the other characters or whatever. That,
well, so, maybe.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I can't always think what.
Yeah, it just felt more like Marky's story to me.
Right, yeah. Right. More from her point of view. Mm-hmm. So, and I said, and it was it was nice that she sort of bonded with some of these other characters most after she found out more about them, the ones who worked for Mrs. Saint, and finding out, even though her, you know, mother was rich and all about appearances, that this other lady had to deal with a mother who was an addict and controlled her whole life in, you know, in a different way. So
yep.
I think that a lot of times people realize they have more in common than they think, even though they're from totally different backgrounds.
Yeah, we forgot to talk about the fact that what's her name was Frederick's daughter, and how yeah. Mrs. Saint found her and brought her into the fold, and never they never spoke of it and all of that. I mean, all this stuff just comes out boof in the final quarter. It's like, but the book wasn't even about all of that. The book's about Marky. I thought it was a bit uneven that in that way.
Yeah, well, like, you know, a more even development about both
each story. Yeah.
Other people.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And a good way to have done that, I think, in my opinion, would have been to not just have the entire story from Marky's POV.
Right. Maybe more of a third person
it was
story.
Third person, or have it be from Marky and from maybe not Mrs. Saint, but maybe from Frederick, or one of the other characters.
Right.
One of the other defectives.
You know, we've read plenty of books, and I have too, where there's alternating points of view, mm-hmm. and sometimes those work really well because you see different sides of the whole story.
Exactly. It feels like you get a more well-rounded story.
Right, mm-hmm. right, exactly.
Yeah, so what's your grade?
Well, I'm being a little bit generous. I said C.
I was generous too. I gave it a D+.
Oh, okay.
Yes!
We're close this time. Usually we're, you know, good ways apart. But yeah, I said, I was just disappointed, especially since it was my pick. I was hoping for so much more. But hopefully the next, well, you've already read our next pick.
Yes, I did.
But hopefully we'll have some better picks. But at the same time, even if they aren't wonderful, there's usually a lot of stuff to discuss.
Yes.
So either way, it works out. Well,
yeah, so this is one where, like I always say, the discussion is better than the book. Like, I always enjoy the discussion about the book more than I did the book. This is one of those.
I
will enjoy the discussion like I've enjoyed chatting about it with you on the podcast.
So there's always something good that comes even out of a not so good book.
Yes, even out of a dud, because the rest of the group seem to, I think it will be unanimously panned.
I think you're right.
Yeah, so I gave it a D+, and I don't know if anyone... Oh, I think Cheryl gave it a C-, I think I saw. So probably everyone will be right around there. And Faith had been in danger of not even finishing it. I don't know if she finished it.
Not sure.
Yeah. All right, listeners, thanks again for tuning in. And that's our discussion of Mrs. Saint and the Defectives by Julie Lawson Timmer. Please join us next time. Next month, we're discussing If Not For You by Debbie Macomber. So we'll be chatting that one up next month. Stay tuned. Bye.
Bye.